Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of the Medicinal Drugs Committee of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, I welcome all of you who have come to listen to one of the very interesting and current topics, I think, for the current time on cardiodiabetes. And I don't think Dr. Ruwanneka Nayaka needs any formal introduction to this audience. He has had a brilliant undergraduate academic career and retired from the Ministry of Health as a consultant cardiologist, the chief of cardiology in Colombo. And I would like to invite sir to deliver this lecture on cardiodiabetes, evidence-based management. I actually happened to listen to him giving this lecture at the Royal Medical Association, and then I thought we should have this lecture for the Colombo audience as well, so we invited him to deliver this presentation. Thank you, sir, for accepting
our invitation. Thank you, Priya Darshini. A very good afternoon to all of you. So I will be speaking on new insights into cardiodiabetes. This is one of the recent textbooks put out by the Indian Cardiac Society. Cardiodiabetes, you will find that the subtitle is a textbook of cardiology. Therefore, cardiodiabetes is a subspecialty, now subspecialty, specialty, now accepted as entering into the province of cardiologists as well. Now, the only credential I have to give this lecture, because I am not an endocrinologist, the only credential I have is that when they are putting this cardiodiabetes update into form, I was invited by the editors to contribute a chapter. And chapter 57 in this book is by me, and therefore it generated the interest that I had in cardiodiabetes. It's a massive textbook of 900 pages or so, and that is why I am interested in this subject. But now, one of the major objectives of treating diabetes mellitus would be to prevent life-threatening, disabling coronary, cerebral and peripheral vascular disease. That is the aim of therapy. The aim of therapy is not to get a normal blood sugar level or a normal HbA1c. We want to improve the quality of life and the quantity of life of the patient. Unfortunately, the currently available anti-diabetic drugs in large measure have sparse evidence of benefit in this regard. We will see as we go on. The data is poor and conflicting, so that clinicians tend to rely on a satisfactory HbA1c as a surrogate for clinical benefit. And we argue and say, we have got down the HbA1c to whatever level that the guidelines have given us, and therefore our patients will do well and their vascular complications, microvascular as well as macrovascular complications, will be less. The new trials do not justify this basis of treatment. We cannot go on surrogate indicators. We need to have concrete evidence that this particular drug or therapy will reduce the macrovascular and the microvascular complications. Now, until the publication of the meta-analysis of rosiglitazone trials by Steve Nissen in 2007 from Cleveland Clinic, that is, it was generally held that tight control of glycemia could directly lead to beneficial effects on the cardiovascular outcomes. Now, I am going to talk about cardiovascular outcomes and not about renal outcomes. However, the rosiglitazone trials prove this to be an incorrect supposition. This is the paper published in 2007 New England Journal of Medicine by Steve Nissen, heading Effect of Rosiglitazone on the Risk of Myocardial Infarction and Death from Cardiovascular Causes. Now, what did he find? He found that rosiglitazone was associated with a significant increase in the risk of myocardial infarction, with an increased risk of death from cardiovascular causes that had borderline significance. Our study, that means Nissen's study, was limited by lack of access to the original source of data, which the company refused to give. Despite these limitations, patients and providers should consider the potential for serious adverse cardiovascular effects of treatment with rosiglitazone for type 2 diabetes. Now, this was the red signal that heralded all this work in cardiodiabetes. Now, there are certainly benefits of lowering the blood sugar. The question that has always remained is, what about the complications of diabetes? And that's the question that comes up in the rosiglitazone debate. Is there proven evidence that lowering blood sugar reduces macrovascular complications, and is there proven evidence that it lowers microvascular complications? On review of the literature, the evidence is reasonably good that lowering blood sugar reduces microvascular complications. Therefore, the albuminuria, the retinopathies, the early nephropathies are all reduced. There is no doubt about that. But the evidence is not clear for macrovascular complications, that is strokes and ischemic coronary artery disease. Now, I'll come to the agents one by one. The metformin, the United Kingdom prospective diabetes study, the UK media study, very famous, found that early initiation of metformin resulted in a 32% reduction in microvascular and macrovascular complications in type 2 obese diabetics. The risk reduction with metformin appears to be significantly better than with sulfonylureas or insulin. This is the UK media's data. Metformin seemed to perform better than insulin or sulfonylurea, as a 39% risk reduction in acute myocardial infarction and 50% risk reduction in coronary deaths for seen with its use. Now, I'll come back to the UK PDS data little later in my lecture, but this has been taken as gospel truth. And most of us, when we are treating diabetes, the first line therapy for obese diabetics would be metformin. Now, sulfonylureas, the first generation drug tolbutamide, has no evidence in its favor. In fact, now, advanced study used glycoside, which is the subsequent generation, did not result in adverse cardiac effects, but had no definite cardiac benefits as well as Accord. Now, the tolbutamide was studied in a very old study, the UDDP, University Group's Diabetes Program, which was a placebo-controlled study in the 1990s, results indicated adverse cardiac effects with tolbutamide. Excess deaths on the tolbutamide arm led to premature termination of this limb of the study. At that time, the investigators did not know why it was so. Now we know the sulfonylurea pathophysiology. And it is true, it blocks the ischemic preconditioning. Now, what is ischemic preconditioning? Ischemic preconditioning is a syndrome that we find that when a patient has repeated insults, ischemic insults to the myocardium, subsequent myocardial infarction becomes lower. That is, if you keep on tying the artery and releasing it, you get some ischemia, and later after about 10 or 15 insults like this to the myocardium, you tie it completely, the infarct that you get is smaller than if the artery had got blocked in toto initially. Now, this ischemic preconditioning is mediated by ATP-dependent potassium channels, which open during ischemia during low ATP levels. Now, the sulfonylureas block the potassium ATP channels, and therefore, there is a pathophysiological basis to say that the sulfonylureas can worsen ischemia. Diphenhydramine and tolbutamide have been shown to experimentally block the potassium-dependent ATP channel. Now, sulfonylureas have to block the potassium ATP because sulfonylureas stimulate insulin secretion from the pancreatic beta cells by closing ATP-sensitive potassium channels in the beta cell plasma membrane. So, that is the action. It has to do so. Now, nicotinamide, the drug that we use in anti-ischemia, enhances ischemic preconditioning, and nicotinamide-induced protection is abolished by diphenhydramine but not by glycoside. Therefore, the mitochondrial, now this ATP-sensitive potassium channels are not there only in the plasma membrane. It is there also in the mitochondrial membranes. Now, the mitochondrial membrane which produces this ATP is the powerhouse of the myocardium. It has a key role to play in ischemic protection. Hence, a sulfonylurea that does not block the mitochondrial potassium ATP channel is desirable to avoid cardiac damage. And we have two such, glimepiride and glycoside, which do not block this mitochondrial potassium ATP. But though we have this pathological, physiological basis for benefit, clinical trials so far have not given any concrete evidence of benefit. Now, we have the secretor box and we have the sensitizers. And the major published report, meta-analysis, done in 2011, where the secretor box were compared with metformin. most insulin secreted box appear to be associated with increased mortality. Now, when you do the studies, the surprising thing, as Steve Beeson says, is trial after trial has shown increased mortality. Nevertheless, it is authorized to continue with these drugs. It is associated with increased mortality and cardiovascular risk compared to metformin. The least risk was associated with glucoside and repaglinide. And based on this study, no generalized distinction could be made between the first and the second generation sulfonylureas. So the evidence is conflicting, but a signal is raised that some of these anti-diabetic drugs are causing enhanced myocardial risk. Now we come to the PPAR gamma agonist, the thiazolidine D-dimers, regarding rosiglitazone, which Steve Neeson initially brought up this problem. Now concerns have been raised regarding the adverse cardiac effects of peroxisome proliferator activator receptor gamma agonist. Now they made a study of 29,000 patients utilizing data from a healthcare insurer, and the patients were selected on either pioglitazone or rosiglitazone, and the hazard ratios were different. The authors concluded that this study showed a 22% relative risk reduction for hospitalization with acute myocardial infarction in type 2 diabetes who were treated with pioglitazone compared to rosiglitazone. So pioglitazone seemed to do better than rosiglitazone. Rosiglitazone was associated with a 34 to 41% higher risk for all-cause mortality compared to pioglitazone, and pioglitazone had a 31% to 39% risk lower risk for all-cause mortality compared to metformin. So now we have, even though Steve Neeson initially said problems are there for rosiglitazone, subsequent analysis have shown that even within this one class, there seems to be a diversity of cardiovascular effects. Of course, these are meta-analysis and there are problems with meta-analysis. Thus, even within a given class of antibiotic agents, individual molecules may have diverse outcomes. This is important to keep in mind. So, what has the American Heart Association and the American College of Cardiology Federation said about this? In a 2010 science advisory from the AHA and the ACCF, that is, those are the cardiology colleges in the United States, regarding the cardiovascular risk of thiazolidine D-dimers, concluded that an association of rosiglitazone and ischemic cardiac outcome is not firmly established because there was only one meta-analysis of Steve Neeson. And Steve Neeson's analysis was problematic for the simple reason that it was only for 6 months. Longer periods of analysis gave lesser harmful effects than what Neeson initially said. With regard to pioglitazone, the same science advisory says that the majority of published studies do not suggest an increased risk of ischemic heart disease. Now, understanding the mechanism of how a drug works has never proven to be a very reliable predictor of what its benefits would be. We know the mechanism, but when it comes to clinical benefit, it is not demonstrable. The peroxisome proliferator activator receptors are a group of nuclear receptor proteins that function as a transcription factors regulating gene expression, and we have the alpha, beta and the gamma. These drugs are all complicated. The pioglitazone and the glitazones are very complicated. The thiazolidine diones are PPAR gamma agonists, and the PPAR gamma drugs are turning on and off a large number of genes because it is a transcription protein inhibitor. So that is why. So they are turning on and turning off a large number of genes, and we do not know what the genes are. We don't know what most of these genes do, and in fact may represent a real problem in the class, because when the thiazolidine D-dimers were being developed, a large number of these drugs actually either did not make it in development or had to be withdrawn because of toxicity. So we have problems. Even though we are saying pioglitazone is good, we have problems. Now a recent 2016 meta-analysis in the BMJ, pioglitazone and cardiovascular outcomes in patients with insulin resistance, pre-diabetes and type 2 diabetes, a systematic analysis, it showed that pioglitazone therapy was associated with lower risk of MACE. MACE means major adverse cardiac events in patients with pre-diabetes or insulin resistance and diabetes. So the entire spectrum of glucose intolerance is taken into account. Risk, however, risk of heart failure, bone fracture and weight gain increased in the pioglitazone group that we all know from our pharmacology. Now last year, the Annals of Translational Medicine also published a meta-analysis on pioglitazone and cardiovascular medicine. Is it good for all? And they said that pioglitazone has so many other factors. Insulin resistance is reduced, plasma triglyceride concentration is reduced, HDL concentration is increased, dense atherogenic LDL is decreased, plasma free fatty acids are decreased, adipocytokines are decreased, procoagulant factors are decreased, and plasma adiponectin is also reduced. So that pioglitazone seems to have a lot of effects other than glucose control in its molecular structure, which we independent of the reduction in plasma glucose concentration. Therefore, these pleiotropic effects of pioglitazone may be the ones that are giving good results and not the drug itself. Consistent with this, pioglitazone has been shown to slow the progression in carotid intimal media thickness in subjects with impaired glucose tolerance. Furthermore, pioglitazone reduced coronary atheroma volume through the IVA studies and decrease the risk of coronary stenosis in type 2 diabetes patients receiving coronary stents. Now, coronary stent patients are easy to study because they submit to second angiographies. Most patients refuse to have angiographies when we do it on an experimental basis. But in patients who have undergone stenting, on the protocol of follow-up, it is easy to do a second angiogram, and the pioglitazone has shown reduced re-stenosis. Lastly, in large clinical outcome studies, pioglitazone significantly lowered the incidence of 3-point MACE, that is non-fatal myocardial infarction, non-fatal stroke and cardiovascular death in type 2 diabetes patients with established cardiovascular disease. So the meta-analysis are now in favor of pioglitazone. But in the proactive study where they used pioglitazone, and in the IRIS study where they use pioglitazone in non-diabetic individuals. Proactive is in diabetics. Non-diabetic individuals study in the IRIS. They had only glucose intolerance. And they showed that pioglitazone caused a 24% reduction in the non-fatal stroke and non-fatal and fatal stroke. Now, it was brought up to the notice of the FDA that this type of meta-analysis has produced results for and against, and therefore it was not accepted as being very good evidence on current standards. The proactive and IRIS studies demonstrated cardiovascular benefit of pioglitazone in type 2 diabetes with established CVD. Because at any given time, the majority of diabetic patients do not have established cardiovascular disease, it is important to determine whether pioglitazone exerts a cardiovascular benefit in type 2 diabetic patients without established cardiovascular disease. And therefore, they produce what is called the TOSCA-E study to answer this question. And it was a well-conducted study, 3,000 patients with diabetes mellitus on maximum dose of metformin, and then given pioglitazone or sulfonylurea as added therapy to metformin, depending on the clinician's preference. The intention to treat analysis demonstrated that both the primary and the main secondary outcomes failed to demonstrate significant difference between the two treatment arms. So this was a failure trial. Even though meta-analysis have shown benefit, when you go to do a clinical trial as a prospective study, we are unable to demonstrate the cardiovascular benefit of pioglitazone. Of course, they say that both the IRIS and the proactive use the full dose of pioglitazone, that is 45 milligrams a day, that the TOSCA, it used only 23 milligrams, and that is the reason why. This is all hypothetical conjecture. You cannot, it may be correct, but unless the clinical trials prove that 45 milligrams will, as a prospective study, give benefit, we are still in limbo in the determination. It is possible that indeed pioglitazone is effective in lowering cardiovascular risk only in secondary prevention, not in primary prevention, and thus only patients with established cardiovascular disease will prevent. Now, when you come to the PPAR gamma, initially the PPAR gamma agonists were said to have a lot of cardiovascular benefits in the lipid profile, etc. But when we gave the rosiglitazone or the pioglitazone or the dosiglitazone, these effects could not be demonstrated. Therefore, it is now found that it is the PPAR gamma which is giving rise to the drop in the blood sugar, but the PPAR gamma alpha is also giving rise to beneficial lipid parameters. And now the saroglitazar has been developed where the alpha and the gamma both are affected, and evidence for reduction in hypercholesterolemia and diabetes control is there, but we do not have clinical data of clinical outcome, of trial data of clinical outcomes. Then we come to the DPP inhibitors, the leptins, the dipeptidase 4 are responsible for degrading incretins. Therefore, when these drugs are given, incretin levels go up. And there are three large double-blind studies now published regarding the benefit of the other. These are all drugs, studies done regarding cardiovascular outcome. Now, why are these studies being done? Because until 1990, I will show the study later, the FDA said any anti-diabetic drug which is proven to reduce blood sugar without adverse effects will be approved, and they approved. But after Steve Nissen's campaigning, the FDA criteria has changed. You have to prove cardiovascular benefit before new drug is being approved. That is why this gliptins carried out these trials. Now the same OTP53, saxagliptin. These are patients with established chronic disease or multiple risk factors. Therefore, these are high-risk patients for ischemic heart disease. They compared saxagliptin to standard therapy, and although the reduction is very important, although the reduction of the HbA1c was significantly better in the saxagliptin arm, the composite endpoint of cardiovascular mortality, non-fatal myocardial ischemic stroke, was the same in both treatment groups. HbA1c is coming down. Cardiovascular effects are not being reduced. There was also a problem with the saxagliptin. Their heart failure was increased. Then they checked out the examine trial, the allogliptin. Again you found these are also patients with acute coronary syndrome. Therefore, these are patients with at high risk of atherosclerotic disease, not high risk at high risk for atherosclerotic events, because they already have atherosclerotic disease. Allogliptin compared to standard therapy. Although allogliptin arm had a low HbA1c level, the cerebral ischemic events were comparable. Of course, hospitalization for heart failure was not increased with allogliptin. Then sitagliptin, which most of us are using in great abundance, the TECOS trial. Again, patients with vascular disease, HDs, coronary, cerebral and peripheral vascular disease, they have poor atherosclerotic burden is high. At 3 years, sitagliptin was non-inferior to placebo with regard to major cardiovascular outcomes, although sitagliptin reduced the HbA1c greater than the standard care. So we find that, again, vildagliptin, a meta-analysis published in 2017, they checked for myocardial infarction, other acute coronary syndromes, cerebrovascular accidents and congestive heart failure. There was no increase for MACE, but no protection either with vildagliptin. So we are reducing the blood sugar. For what? To reduce simply to get a normal biochemical report. Or, of course, you might argue to reduce the microvascular complication. But the major death-causing problems are not being reduced by these drugs that we are using. Then we have the incretin mimetics. Now the DPP-4 ones reduce the degree of the metabolism, the degrading of the incretin. Now we have the agonists of GLP-1. The incretin mimetics, and two drugs have been tested in this class in well-conducted clinical trials published 2017. First is the LEADER trial, the liraglutide. Cardiovascular outcomes, this was a double-blind study. Liraglutide in a placebo in a cohort of patients with high cardiovascular risk. Now you must remember, we are not talking about primary prevention. We are talking about secondary prevention. In all these trials, secondary prevention. Because unless the event rate in a given clinical trial is high, statistical significance cannot be demonstrated. And primary prevention will have a low incidence of events, and they are finding it difficult to prove the benefit, and therefore they are using it in high cardiovascular risk, which is good for us. We want to know what is happening really in our patients. The liraglutide treated group had a significant reduction in the primary endpoints composite of first occurrence of death from cardiovascular causes, non-fatal MI and non-fatal stroke. The number needed to treat to prevent one event in 3 years was the primary outcome and 98 for death from any cause. Here we are seeing now for the first time an agent giving cardiovascular benefit. Then we have the sustained 6. Of course there are sustained 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and the last one was the sustained 6 where they use semaglutide. The results were encouraging regarding cardiovascular outcomes and basically followed the leader results. So the semaglutide and the liraglutide both gave benefit in cardiovascular disease events. It doesn't mean that all these in the same group will have the benefit. Not all glutides have shown cardiovascular benefit. For example, exenatide. The clinical trials have not shown benefit. They are within a group of, within one class of drugs also, the diverse molecules have diverse effects so long as cardiovascular benefit is concerned. Now the problem with the liraglutide and the semaglutide are that these are injectable drugs. Therefore, it is not very popular with us because we cannot be giving these patients injections at least once a week or so. They must get these injections, very costly. And therefore, they have now tried to give semaglutide orally. And how are they giving it orally? They have combined it with another compound which gives rise to this. Of course, the trial that I am putting up now is not a cardiovascular effect trial. It is a trial which shows that oral semaglutide and subcutaneous semaglutide give equal glycemic control. That's all. It is quite possible that later on they might say that but the oral one does not cause it. So we will now go very quickly because this thing. Now these are liraglutide and semaglutide are peptides or protein-based drugs. And proteolytic degradation in the gastrointestinal tract poses a significant challenge for developing oral preparations. The first oral GLP-1 analog using semaglutide in a tablet was co-formulated with the absorption enhancer called SNAC, the sodium aminocaprylate, which when you give with the tablet causes a localized increase in the pH in the stomach, leads to higher solubility, and also the high protein is said protects against the proteolytic degradation of semaglutide. So the pharmaceutical industry is now trying to give these drugs which have been shown to have benefit in an oral formulation, and if successful and the clinical trials are good, then we might have one benefit that is given. Now, we will now skip the pathophysiology. Now we come to another group of drugs. So we have two drugs now with cardiovascular benefit. All the others in limbo. The sodium glucose co-transporter inhibitor, what are called the glyphosates, and two important double-blind clinical trials regarding the glyphosates have been published. The first is the EMPA-REG outcome study, EMPA-glyphosate in cardiovascular event trial. The one of the two trials using SGLT2 inhibitor, which has been completed, and all patients in this study group had established cardiovascular disease. Patients were randomized to receive empagliflozin or placebo at 3.1 years of follow-up. Relative risk of major cardiac and cerebral outcomes was significantly reduced by over 30% with the test done. Again, we have a benefit. Empagliflozin is showing reduced cardiovascular events. The major benefit was from the reduction of deaths from cardiovascular causes, but not by non-fatal myocardial infarctions. With regard to strokes, however, empagliflozin seemed to raise an adverse signal. There was significant reduction in the hospitalization for heart failure, but the number of strokes went up slightly, and we say it raised an adverse signal. But the cardiovascular effects are very good. Therefore, we do not give empagliflozin for patients with a past history of TIA or stroke. Now, the SGLT2 inhibitors available now are empagliflozin, canagliflozin, and dapagliflozin. These drugs have a multiplicity of actions, not only reduction in sugar, they reduce the blood pressure, they have a slight diuretic action, therefore it is beneficial in heart failure, they mitigate albuminuria, and it is unclear which action is responsible for the reduction in cardiovascular outcomes with these agents. Now, that was the EMPA-REG, Now we come to the canvas trial, which used canagliflozin dosing. Again, these patients were high risk for cardiovascular disease. They were recruited to the canagliflozin dosing or the placebo. Follow-up was 182 weeks, and the major coronary cerebral artery events were significantly reduced by canagliflozin. Again, we have a benefit demonstrated. It also showed evidence for renal protection. However, again, an adverse signal is raised of distal amputation going up, very slight, and it has on reassessment been shown that actually the amputation occurred after the canagliflozin had been stopped for the trial, and when the patients were not on canagliflozin. These are the details of the canagliflozin trial. The canagliflozin trial tested for primary as well as secondary prevention of cardiovascular events, and it is shown by canagliflozin in the CANVAS program that the risk is reduced for ischemic heart disease in the primary as well as the secondary arm. We will skip all this. So that is all this. So it is safe in primary. Now there is another trial going on. It is called the CREDENCE study. This is a study which is concentrating on the renal endpoints in diabetes with nephropathy and with established diabetic nephropathy. Now, why is this important? It is important because when you are treating a patient with diabetes, you can't treat only for cardiovascular outcome. You have to treat the patient in total. And if the major problems are the cardiovascular disease, stroke, and also renal, then we must have evidence that the nephropathy is also being good. And this will provide more evidence. Now, the CREDENCE study has not been published. But we know that Janssen has prematurely ended the CREDENCE trial early because the trial gave positive results for benefit. Therefore, the monitors of the trial have authorized the conductors of the trial to stop the trial. When the full details are published, we will know the details. But now, the protection for the renal problems have been proven by the CREDENCE trial with canagliflozin, and therefore, it has been prematurely stopped. Now, I have been speaking of several groups of anti-diabetic drugs. In 2018, the JAMA published a systematic review of the sodium glucose co-transport inhibitors, the glucagon-like peptide 1 agonist, and the PPP4 inhibitors. Therefore, they checked patients treated with empagliflozin and canagliflozin, patients treated with liraglutide and semaglutide, patients treated with sitagliptin, vinalgliptin, transaxacliptin, etc., etc. For all-cause mortality in patients with type 2 diabetes, published in the JAMA last year. And what did they find? The comparative clinical efficacy of the SGLT2 inhibitors, the GLP-1 agonists, and the DPP-4 inhibitors for the treatment of diabetes is unknown. That's the importance of the trial. It was to compare the efficacies of these three groups of drugs on mortality and cardiovascular endpoints using network meta-analysis. In this network meta-analysis, the use of the SGLT2 inhibitors or the GLP-1 agonists was associated with lower mortality than the DPP-4 inhibitors or placebo or no treatment. Use of DPP-4 inhibitors, that is sitagliptin, was not associated with lower mortality than placebo or no treatment. Even to treat or not with the cardiovascular effects are the same, even to give the sitagliptin or not. And therefore, this meta-analysis confirmed what the individual studies have been telling us for the past 5 years or so. Now, the SGLT of the empagliflozin and canagliflozin are very, what shall I say, problematic because they cause excretion of sodium, glucose from the urine. Therefore, if the patient has any tendency to develop a urine tract infection or vaginal infections with fungi, etc., this will enhance it because the glucose is now coming out of the urine. Therefore, you take the urine, it will be big red. When you give empagliflozin and canagliflozin, you can't take urine and take them. It is big red. And they have a diuresis. And because of the diuresis and the diuretic action of these drugs, they tend to pass urine and therefore tend to get dehydrated. That is why it is recommended that we tell these patients that they must take in a lot of water while doing this. One problem is diabetic ketoacidosis, and these people are thought to get very non-specific symptoms when they are developing ketoacidosis while on the glyphosis. Nausea, vomiting, anorexia, abdominal pain, excessive thirst, difficulty breathing, confusion, undue fatigue and sleepiness, and therefore these vague symptoms have to be kept in mind by the clinician using this empagliflozin or canagliflozin because it may be a harbinger of diabetic ketoacidosis. Empagliflozin is now available in this country, not the original is available, but the Japanese mediated Bangladesh product is also available. Canagliflozin, the original will come, but we don't have it. Now, because of lack of time, I will not go into all these details. Now, how do these empagliflozin or glyphosate cause cardiovascular benefit? How? What is the mechanism? Actually, we don't know the mechanism. Now, if you take the empiric outcome and the cardiovascular program, and you sign that the hazard ratios are always in the beneficial range, whether the patient had heart failure or no heart failure, it is always in the beneficial range. This data you know, and it improves ventricular loading, improves cardiac metabolism and bioenergetics, myocardial sodium and proton exchange inhibition occurs, reduction of necrosis and fibrosis, adipokinase, cytokine production, epicardial adiposity mass are all reduced. Now how this affects, how this is mediated, we do not know, but these effects are described. And a problem that I have is, all these mechanisms prove that the LV function will improve. They tell us nothing about the atheroma, atherosclerotic process itself. So even though these mechanisms are postulated and given, as clinicians, we are a little doubtful about accepting all this. Now, Dr. Nissan, a co-investigator and leader, comments about the potential impact of these drugs on patients with diabetes and cardio. This is an interview which I am quoting. To change the clinical paradigm, many endocrinologists were upset about proposing cardiovascular outcome trials for diabetic drugs. They wanted to continue performing this in the United States, performing trials for lowering blood sugar alone. I believe in evidence-based medicine, Nissan says. You must study the problem, not just measure biochemical markers. So I stuck my neck out by making these recommendations to the FDA. If we hadn't changed the way these trials are done after 2007, that the trials changed, the paradigm of these trials changed, we wouldn't have known this because we would have gone on HbA1c. Whereas the FDA, because of these people who canvassed for this cardiovascular outcome trials to be conducted, we now have the evidence for these trials. When we developed the guidance for testing these drugs, it was about ruling out harm. It was ruling out harm. We hoped they would lower blood sugar and do no harm, but also reduce cardiovascular events. Our dream came true. Both drugs, that is both classes of drugs, EMPA and the leader, which used liraglutide, more decorbid, reduced morbidity and most mortality. Although most cardiologists do not treat diabetic patients for their blood sugar, cardiologists should be talking to the endocrinologists about the choice of drugs for patients with cardiovascular disease. They should share the decision-making process. Now, is there a shared mechanism between the drug classes in these two trial groups? These new classes of drugs with novel mechanism of action, there are no links between them. Empagliflozin changes the way the kidneys retain sugar, causing more sugar to spill into the urine. And the effect of liraglutide is more complex and complicated, almost hormone-like, and its mechanism is not entirely clear. Is it likely that the EMPA-REC and the LIDA trials are indicating a class effect of the co-transporter inhibitors and the incretin degraders? No one knows. A clinical trial of a weaker drug in the same class as liraglutide was not effective, so for example, exenatide. On the other hand, a long-acting GLP-1 analog showed benefit in the recent sustained 6 trial, which I have already shown. Now, do you see potential parallels here with the use of statins or other widely used drug classes for cardiovascular disease? The magnitude of benefit was quite substantial and in the range of what we see with the statins. Now, statins, we are seeing a wide range, we are seeing a enhanced benefit. In fact, most patients in the LEADER study and 2/3 in the EMPA-REC study were being treated with statins. So, the new drugs are providing incremental benefit on top of statins. Now this is important. For example, if you have the ACE inhibitor trials and the ARB trials, the older trials gave no benefit, the new trials are giving benefit, and now it is shown that it is because the new trials included patients who want statins, whereas the older people, older trials had no great proportion of patients on statins. So the concurrent therapy that is going on is important, and these drugs that we are describing gives actually an added incremental benefit. Can we use these drugs in pre-diabetes? The clinical evidence is not available. Then I come to the last of the drugs that I am going to discuss, the alpha glucosidase inhibitors. Of course, you know all this, ACARBOs are a class of oral glucosidase drugs which act by altering the intestinal absorption of carbohydrates through inhibition of their conversion into simple sugars, monosaccharides, and thus decrease the availability of carbohydrates in the body, significantly lowering blood glucose levels. So we are using ACARBOs in this country, the other two are not available, I believe. Then minimal risk for hypoglycemia, occasional gastrointestinal disturbance. Now why I put this up, alpha glucosidase inhibitors, is that it has been more significant in Asian trials than those in the West, due to the predominant consumption of a carbohydrate rich diet among Asian populations. That is why it interests us, because it has practical implications for our therapy. It is beneficial, ACARBOs is beneficial because it improves the lipemia. And a recent meta-analysis showed that it reduces cardiovascular events. Now, with the new paradigms coming through, you can't do meta-analysis and say there is benefit. You have to do a proactive trial and demonstrate that there is cardiovascular benefit. And therefore, they came to do what is called, it's a reasonable hypothesis, I will go quickly, the ACE trial, the ACARBOs cardiovascular evaluation trial done in China, where in the randomized placebo controlled double blind second prevention trial, large trial, 7,500 patients with coronary heart disease. That is, they had a myocardial infarction, they had unstable angina or recovered current stable angina. They were randomized into two groups, ACARBOs three times a day and the other one single machine placebo 1:1. But the trial was negative. This is the problem. We can have a huge theoretical superstructure giving, indicating benefit. When you go into the clinics and conduct prospective trials, the trials are not giving benefit except for the four drugs that I have mentioned so far. That is empagliflozin, canagliflozin, the liraglutide and the semaglutide. So that is important. So it is not that the other drugs are to be discarded. But if you are taking patients with high risk cardiovascular disease, one of those four has to be included in the therapeutic armamentarium of these patients in order to reduce cardiovascular mortality. It is evidence based and the evidence is very good. It is not meta-analysis. Meta-analysis evidence is thought to be inferior to the properly conducted clinical trial. Now what about insulin? Now insulin can have diverse effects on the cardiovascular disease causation and progression. Insulin has beneficial effects which are anti-inflammatory, anti-thrombotic and antioxidative. And this is important to know because insulin has this effect. Now our problem is there are trials which show that large insulin doses seem to be associated with increased cardiovascular risk. We know that type 2 diabetics are insulin resistant. Their serum insulin levels are high. They are not insulin deficient. They are hyperinsulinemic. And the insulin resistance, the IR, is thought to be one of the important causes of atherosclerotic disease in diabetes. Now, insulin resistance is what is called common soil of many major cardiovascular diseases such as diabetes, coronary heart disease and hypertension and heart failure. Recent studies have revealed that in addition to the metabolic modulation, insulin exerts direct cardiovascular protective effects. But in the presence of insulin resistance, there is a problem of giving more insulin to these patients because the problem has occurred. Now I have been talking, I don't know what the time is, there's about 10 minutes or so, no? We have been talking about hyperglycemia. Now we come to this concept of hypoglycemia. It is very important. Although hypoglycemia is well established as a causative factor of atherosclerosis, the role played by hypoglycemia is less clear. The lack of benefit from strict glycemic control regimens, such as in the Accord and the Advance, very tight control of blood sugar, so that most of these people with tight control actually develop episodes of hypoglycemia. It may lead to increased incidence of hypoglycemic episode, supporting the view that even asymptomatic hypoglycemia which occurs in the night has atherogenic potential. Hypoglycemia is now known to cause fluffiness of the endothelium, giving rise to atherosclerosis, predisposing to atherosclerosis, and therefore, if you are treating a diabetic, doing tight control is now not seem to be evidence-based, to my mind at least. Insulin-treated diabetes mellitus type 2 and type 1 appear to have increased risk of cardiovascular disease related to the occurrence of hypoglycemia. Now we have a lot of ongoing trials which will give us more data, and if we have to now prepare a list in hierarchical order of how we are going to select drugs for our patients, perhaps we would put metformin first and then put the glyphosine second, empagliflozin and canagliflozin. We put the liraglutide and we will put the semaglutide. Subsequently we will try with pioglitazone and the glycoside, treponinide and the gliptins will come sub very low, and the acarbose also. But then selecting drugs cannot always be done on clinical trial basis. There will be so much of other confounding factors such as the availability, the cost, and the patient's other pathophysiological strata which will indicate to us. But certainly the first three seem to be quite evidence-based. Now though we say, now I have already said listing of these drugs will be controversial, as numerous studies using small series could well be suggesting benefit of harm from anti-diabetic drug not confirmed by large studies. So clinicians are well advised to keep abreast of the new trials. Just a note on metformin. It is widely recommended first-line treatment for type 2 diabetes, but the evidence about the cardiovascular effects of metformin is primarily based on a small subgroup of patients in the UK PDS trial. And that was only 342 patients. Conducted more than 2 decades ago, this level of evidence does not compare with the modern cardiovascular outcomes trials which randomize thousands of patients with diabetes. So although we are quoting UKPDS and saying metformin is beneficial, yes, it may be beneficial. Nevertheless, it is a very small subset of the UKPDS, 342 patients on which we are basing our conclusion. A note on insulin. Similarly, few data on the outcomes associated with insulin in type 2 diabetes are available despite multiple approved brand options. The exception is the Origin trial, which used an initial glargine intervention, which reported no increase in the cardiovascular events with the use of insulin glargine compared to placebo in newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes and pre-diabetes, all of mild elevations of HbA1c. So the evidence for insulin is also poor. Nevertheless, as I said before, we are talking about cardiovascular outcomes. Keep in mind the microvascular complications, keep in mind the renal complications, and for the microvascular complications, definitely we cannot allow the HbA1c to be very high, we have to keep it low. How low? HbA1c. That is the next question. Now in 2017, this meta-analysis was published in the BMJ. Glycolated hemoglobin A1c as a risk factor for cardiovascular outcomes and all-cause mortality in diabetic and non-diabetic populations. They are trying to answer the question from the data gleaned from the new trials, which did not reduce the HbA1c very low, nevertheless demonstrated cardiovascular benefit. What are the HbA1c levels that were there? So we want to determine the optimal levels of HbA1c for preventing cardiovascular events. It may not hold true for all clinical events. So it is a reliable risk factor for all cause and cardiovascular mortality. This has been proven for a long time. The findings establish optimal HbA1c levels for the lowest all cause and cardiovascular mortality from the trials now published. It is 6 to 8%. That seems to be all right if you are using the new drugs. If we are using the proven drugs. In patients with diabetes, 5-6% without diabetes, patients without diabetes, this also seems to be given. This of course is an old recommendation. Going allowing the HbA1c to go up to about 8 is a new recommendation. It's not a recommendation, it has not entered the guidelines, but this is the trend of thought in the published literature that we are seeing now. Therefore, they are contemplating bringing in what is called a hypothesis on non-glycemic effect benefit and the hypoglycemic effect benefit in cardiovascular disease. That is, a certain agent, say for example, empagliflozin, may be reducing cardiovascular effects by what is called a non-glycemic effect. It may be reducing also the effects by glycemic reduction in the glycemic effects, but there might be a non-glycemic effect as well. And how they came to these conclusions is also a very controversial subject. They are postulating that atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, if you can reduce the HbA1c to just 0.9%, that is by 0.9%, not to 0.9%, by 0.9%, and a cardiovascular benefit occurs within 10 years, this is a non-glycemic effect. Same, if you can reduce it to less than 1%, less by 1%, and a cardiovascular benefit after 5 years, this is also a non-glycemic effect. So there are benefits in these drugs which are non-glycemic, and this is important to keep in mind. Now the second, we will now skip because I have already exceeded 1 hour, and we will come to HDA, because that was the chapter I wrote in this multi-author textbook. And now we are recognizing what is called the binaural functionality of HDA. Although HDA levels have been accepted as showing an inverse correlation with atherosclerotic vascular disease, the evidence is not consistent. Drugs such as torsitamib, which work through the L-CAT mechanism enzyme, raised HDL, but the mortality went up. And therefore it was withdrawn from the market. In monogenic conditions, these are genetic conditions, monogenic conditions which lead to higher or level HDL levels, the risk of ischemic heart disease does not appear to always move in the direction expected by a strong inverse relationship. It does not. Hence, the exact mechanism by which HDL exerts protection against atherosclerotic disease remains unresolved. That is partly due to the fact that HDLC levels reflect the total cholesterol pool. So when you assess the HDL in a blood sample, it has HDL which has come from other sources and also from the cholesterol efflux from the periphery to the center. But this HDL might be coming from other sources as well. And you have no way of distinguishing the pathophysiology or origin of this HDL. You are looking at the total HDL and you are saying it does not. Now, we have now evidence to show dysfunctional HDL. That is, though HDL is usually antithrombotic, anti-inflammatory and antioxidative, the dysfunctional HDL is pro-oxidative, pro-thrombotic, pro-oxidative and pro-thrombotic. And we see this in diabetes, end-stage renal disease and atherosclerotic ischemic heart disease. The HDL remains high, but it does not cause it. So it is due to the continuous remodeling of the lipidome and the proteome of the HDA particle explains the dysfunctionality. We have no time to go into the discussion of that. So a large body of evidence now indicates that dysfunctional HDL is both pro-inflammatory and pro-oxidative, and this occurs in these three disease entities. Now why I brought it up is, when we treat these patients with ischemic heart disease, we have to bring in the treatment of atherosclerosis and statins as well. And that is why it is important to concentrate more on the LDL than the HDL in these patients. The HDL is routinely brought down, consistently brought down by the statins. Statins reduce HDL. Statins will reduce the LDL, but it also reduces the HDL. So therefore, you have a patient whose HDL may be very good initially. You are treated with your high-dose statins and your HDL is coming down. Don't worry, we are not worrying too much. The guidelines now say, concentrate on the LDL. So I will conclude. The goals of treatment of type 2 diabetes are to reduce the risk of diabetic complications and as a result improve the quality and possibly the quantity of life. For several decades, alternative guidelines instructed clinicians to strictly control glucose level of patients with diabetes to accomplish these goals. In addition, in the 1990s, the FDA began to approve drugs for the treatment of diabetes based on HbA1c as the outcome. The prevailing belief was that risk reduction could be achieved by a clinical focus on reaching target values of HbA1c agnostic to the strategy employed. This belief, analogous to the early notions about lipid lowering, persisted despite the failure of trials evaluating the type glycemic targets to reduce the risk of heart disease or improve the survival. And so, first, the anti-diabetic agent appears to be more important than the actual blood sugar level achieved. HbA1c level of 6 to 8 is acceptable in diabetic patients so long as the protective agents are used in the therapy. Non-glycemic effects of drugs are conjectural, has been responsible for cardiovascular benefit, and the accepted drugs in these are empagliflozin, mimosat, canagliflozin, also here, liraglutide and semaglutide. Metformin stays, albeit poor data, but nevertheless it is so ingrained in our practice, no guideline has instructed us to take out metformin. It is there. The diabetic lipid profile may affect the beta cell function, altering insulin secretion. This segment of my talk I omitted because of the time factor. And finally, the binaural functionality of HDL makes it a poor target in treating diabetic ketoacidosis disease. You cannot concentrate on HDL, you have to concentrate on the LDL when you treat the diabetic ketoacidosis disease. And that brings me to the end of my talk. If you say thank you, but he's not saying that. Yes. So what I have tried to do is to give the new summarize for you the new insights that we have in managing cardiodiabetes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I hope you wouldn't mind a few questions if they have from the audience.
Yeah,
I have a few questions.
Yes.
Now you know this. Coronary artery disease is a long process, and you have produced these changes with new drugs over 3 year period. And they are on so many other drugs, with so many other pathological processes going on, lipids and blood pressure, all that. Now these groups they have taken to compare should be comparable in those aspects as well. I hope these people have gone into all that. You know, there are cardiovascular drugs which say more benefits than just lowering the blood pressure. So all that has been looked carefully compared before attributing that difference over the 3 year period to this diabetic drug. Is that right? That must be a very, very complex process.
But it has been done. I only presented the evidence for the statin therapy as concurrent therapy.
Yeah.
And all these patients now, because they are on high risk groups, on aspirin therapy. So all these patients are on the routine therapy and not only on anti-diabetes therapy.
And even when you treat the hypertension in the two groups, those with cardiovascular benefits have been used in the group.
You see, these trials are conducted by experts who would have thought of this problem and then done what is called nutrition studies, no? To eliminate, yes. So, though the details are not given by me, these are utterly comparable groups of patients with similar treatment profile.
So if you conduct this type of trial with metformin and the older drugs, now these have been conducted because they can't approve the drugs without showing the benefit. If you conduct similar trials with older drugs which have been discarded now, they might have similar benefits shown.
Yes, but the point is, with the older drugs, increased risk was demonstrated. Therefore, if you are going to ask the ethical committee to let you conduct this type of trial with the older drugs, you are talking about tolbutamide and glibenclamide.
Yeah.
Yes. then you are having a problem, because a drug which has been proven to increase atherosclerotic disease and cardiovascular outcomes, you are now asking to do another trial. We are going to get into problems. I mean, we can do it in Sri Lanka, but I don't know whether you have general permission.
No.
But the second one is, if you come to drugs like glycoside and rimipride, which have shown equal, or what shall I say, comparable results, not increased nor reduced, again we are having a problem, because the well-conducted trials are there. The advanced and the accord trials are there with these drugs. And therefore, again conducting another trial with the hope of, I mean, how can you justify a trial?
I am not suggesting that you do trials, but the difference could have been due to those fact. Now say at the time these dolutamide was shown, were the drugs used for hypertension? Like now, ones that are known to be better.
Obviously not.
Yeah.
But then at the time the group not on dolutamide was on the same high end as many drugs. They were on the same drugs because it's in the same side piece.
Actually, if I may come in, sir, I think you are raising a very valid point, because each of these trials, we have to actually do a very critical review of the methodology that has been used and the other confounding factors, that will affect the outcomes of each of these trials. So, actually, those things have to be taken into account before really going into the final outcome. And also, talking about metformin, I think it's actually a question why people are not doing a head-to-head comparative trial with metformin, because metformin, the UKPDS has shown moderate benefit, but why are these people who are doing these trials, the companies, not doing with head-to-head comparison with metformin? So one of the reasons could be if the results are thought to be not that favorable, then it will be a negative point for the trial.
More than that, I think metformin is not being used for the clinical trial because there is no one to sponsor trial.
Exactly.
Metformin is such a cheap drug now available as non-proprietary, and therefore no one is going to spend millions and millions to establish that metformin is needed. Whereas the new drugs get to accept the economic
cost. What I am saying is as a comparator. So with a new drug as a comparator, they are not using metformin. Because I think they are, probably because of the concern that it may be shown inferior to metformin.
When these studies are done, for example, the liraglutide study, it was the Steve Nissen himself was one of the investigators. Now, this is a person who is antagonistic to claiming any cardiovascular benefit for any drug. So, the critical analysis and the analytical apparatus used to evaluate these trials, though I gave it in very brief, actually goes into a large number of pages. How the Lancet and all published 30, 40 pages for a trial. But it is, I think, established data. And now with the trial after trial proving evidence, for example, the Credence trial proving benefit in nephropathy, is also going to be a very major therapeutic avenue that we have to.
So 3 years, benefit and 3 years, are they being followed up even later after producing?
All these trials will follow up, no?
Yes.
All these trials will follow up, and 5 years later we will get a follow up result going on. And now your question, if I understood properly, was that atherosclerotic disease is a long drawn out process. You are showing benefit in 3 years. How can this be so? Because you are postulating that atherosclerotic regression has occurred and therefore the ischemic heart disease is going on. But that is not so. Chronic stable angina becoming atherosclerotic acute coronary syndrome is due to the instability of the plaque. That is why we are interested in the plaque stability. These drugs will have pleiotropic effects on the plaque stability and not only on atherosclerotic volume. So the mechanism of benefit cannot be pinpointed at the present moment, but you can't always say that this is causing regression of atherosclerosis and giving the benefit. That I think is a fallacy. We are stabilizing the plaque, and therefore This is my theory. Yeah, and therefore, the mortality rates are coming.
Yeah, I think probably we will need to wait for a few more years for us to, you know, come to a definitive conclusion whether, you know, these are much superior to the existing, you know, second line. Because first line anyway is metformin, this existing second and third line. Because I think there are, you know, a lot of reports coming about furious gangrene associated with metformin dosing. So, yeah, so a lot of concern about furious gangrene, and some patients have succumbed to that as well.
So, occurring even in females.
Yeah, occurring in females.
Not only in gangrene, but also the urinary tract infection and also the amputations.
Yeah, that's right.
But then the amputation problem, of course, has been solved because it has been shown that actually these amputations occurred after the categorization trial was over and they were not on the drug at that present. So, I don't think we can give hard and fast.
The other worrying thing is there is so much of urgency on the part of the people who produce these drugs to show that there is benefit registered.
Yeah.
That is the one we have to guard against. 3 years, I feel, is quite short to show benefit.
But they are shown benefit.
Yes, but we know that the benefit may not be there.
Unless you say that they have
watched. You wait a little more, another 2 years, things may be different. They
are not the unless you say that they have all picked up the data.
Just like the COX-2 inhibitor story, they had to withdraw it from the market because of the side effects that were noted later. But certainly seems promising data, but we had to wait, I think, a few more years until all the concerns about the side effects come to light, as well as I think.
Till the evidence comes, shall we not
use it for the most important kind of therapy? Individualized therapy, definitely, you know, taking each patient's condition and then taking a decision. I think we have come to a very interesting and a very useful current topic, and I would like to pay our appreciation to Dr. Ruwanekanayake, who presented a lot of evidence actually, because as you saw, he went through so many trials which are published, and the data summarized beautifully. So thank you, sir, for taking the trouble to give an excellent presentation and giving some information about the current evidence. Thank you very much.